Good evening once again, friends. Thanks for joining for this webinar. And the reading for this evening is June 7th from, of course, Living Wisely, Living Well. Kriyanandaji writes here, "Look people straight in the eyes, not daringly as liars do, who look at but not into people's eyes, but rather with the wish to include other people in your thoughts and feelings." A very beautiful line, beautiful lines, and we'll come back to them because at three places he puts words in italics. And on some level it may seem like not perhaps such an important, of course the teachings are all important, but sometimes we may, as you say, read them but not be able to understand, and then subsequently we are unable to practice them. So Kriyanandaji is writing and placing emphasis on this very simple teaching, which perhaps in maybe some other practices or traditions is not even a teaching after all, you know. But think about it, we are using our eyes somewhere close to 15 hours a day, and he's giving us a very simple advice over here, how to look at people. And of course he's saying look at them straight and not like straight, you know, into their eyes, as if, you know, intimidating them, certainly not looking at them, as he says, you know, just like coldly, as if not expecting anything, you know, from them, or wishing they not say anything. But he's saying actually use your eyes as a tool. We want, and this is a form of communication, you might say, through the eyes. For example, you know, Kriyanandaji also used to say smile through your eyes, and that he used to say bring your heart's feelings and project them gently through the eyes. Likewise, he's saying over here that it's a form of communication, and in your, while you're having some thoughts, feelings, he said express them. Look at people, how does he put it? Into people's eyes and include them into whatever you're doing. So a very interesting topic, and I'll share a few stories and insights that Kriyanandaji and Yoganandaji gave on that. Also, I found a very, while I was preparing for this satsang, I found actually for the first time a very interesting medical correlation to something Yoganandaji said, and I was very thrilled. And as it happens normally, I and my two other medical colleagues in Pune, Guru Bhais, whenever we find some, you know, insight like this or understanding, whether it is of energization exercises, meditation or something new that we read, it is so much, you can feel it's, you know, from your field. So we are very enthusiastic to share that and kind of confirm our thoughts with one another. But I want to start, friends, this evening with something Nayaswami Devi said about a year or two ago. And this was about the altar that we have in Ananda. And you know, you will know it has Yoganandaji, his guru Sri Yukteswarji, Lahari Mahashraya, who was Sri Yukteswarji's guru, Mahavatar Babaji, and finally in the center we have Krishna and Christ in a painting. And she said a very beautiful thing that sometimes, you know, we want to learn, and we are very fortunate actually on our path to not only have such a line of masters to guide us, but also their actual photographs or paintings of, you know, just the way they looked. So this way we can bring a focus to our devotion. And also they say that just looking at the guru, their eyes, their face, it actually can bring deep enlightenment and grace into our lives. We should not underestimate that. How Lahari Mahashaya told one of his devotees who asked for a picture, he said, if you treat it as a, you know, photo, that's what, how it will remain. If you treat it as a blessing, it will heal you, it can heal. And so that concept of looking at the face, also more closely eyes of the guru, that in India is known as darshan. That they may not say anything to you, they may actually not even look at you. If they look, that's even such a great blessing, we feel that blessing right away. But just us looking at them, and many times people say, oh, I went for a darshan, I just went to look. I remember reading about Rajarshi Janakananda that you know, his gardener, after finishing his daily work, he used to stay in the same campus as Rajarshi Janakanandaji, and he would go home, take a bath, wear fresh clothes, do his brief meditation, and then end of the day he would come with his little son and they would knock on Rajarshi's door and just look at him, bow before him before they went to bed. I found that extremely sweet. That is darshan. But how can we benefit from the pictures on our altar? There are many ways. But the one Deviji mentioned was, she said, you see, each of our masters is also giving us a different teaching just by the way if we observe their eyes. For example, she said, of course, Christ and Krishna, you know, we have a painting of them, but she said that if we look at Mahavatar Babaji, who's our param guru, his eyes are actually not even looking at us. They are slightly above. So he is in this world, as we know. He is caring for us all, but he is teaching us that ultimately your gaze, your vision, your true home, where we can, you might say, really meet him, be with him, get to know him, is actually not even on this plane at all. And that's a very simple, you might say, clear teaching from his eyes. Then his disciple, Lahari Mahashayaji, look at his eyes. There's only one photograph available of him, and those eyes are, as Yogananda ji put, half closed and half open. That is the ideal position of deep meditation, the position of the eyes and eyelids in deep meditation. The gaze is up and the lower eyelid comes up, and he's showing us that we can reach there through the position of eyes this way, and he's slightly more, he's, you know, on our plane a little bit, you might say. Then we have the picture of Sri Yukteswarji, and he's looking very straight at us. And he is saying that, you know, before we go on to the high estates, what is the kind of training we have to go through? Are you doing your work? Do you understand? You know, very gently, calmly, you might even say eternally, that gaze has been gifted to us to guide us, to discipline us also. But you look at those gaze, and you know, you after a while you look left or right, and you very quickly get the message he's trying to give, you might say. But then, of course, Yogananda ji, who took responsibility, you might say, of us all who are on this path, his eyes are something we can very clearly, right now, all of us relate to. Actually, most of us came on the path by seeing the picture on the book Autobiography of a Yogi, or through, you know, some advertisement. And so many people say, those eyes, I saw those eyes, he was looking at me, he called me, he came to me, I had never seen such beautiful eyes. Some people say, I had seen those eyes in a dream. So many ways, it's a pair of eyes, but those are divine eyes. In a master, it is God who looks at us. And you might say, that is the reading over there. Yogananda, and he's accessible. You can see there's a benign smile on his face. His eyes are very kind, open, looking at us, of course. Then at the same time, he is including us. And this is a very deep practice in itself, friends. Yogananda ji said, even higher than all the techniques, including Kriya, is attunement. Kriyananda ji said, actually, Master would not ask the question, how is your Kriya practice going, so much as he would exhort disciples to say, he would say, be in tune with me. And of course, all those tools, techniques, books, writings, chants, our behavior is part of the process. It brings us in tune. But another very simple tool he gave us, which I'm sure all of us would love to do more, he said, look into the eyes. And look into his eyes. There are so many photographs available. Take one which is needed for you, which helps you, which is exuding a certain quality that you need to develop or grow through, and you will see that those eyes help you a lot. I'm not sure if you have heard this counsel of his. He said, if you want to develop more devotion, look into the left eye of the master, of the guru. If you want to develop reason, understanding, look into the right eye. It's such a wonderful teaching. And when I was telling you, I found something or discovered or felt something that this evening, I was saying that, wow, this is so beautiful, because actually the left eye gets its connection from the right side of the brain, and likewise the right receives it from the left. And if you know, we often say, oh, he is left-sided or right-sided, like in the sense brain activity. The right side of the brain is the creative side, which loves music, arts, poetry, inspiration, abstract thinking. All these are more, if you are one of those, then you can say your brain is right-sided. If you're, and that feeds the left eye. Likewise, he was saying the right eye, which gets it from the left side of the brain, is more logic-oriented. Science, mathematics, logic, reasoning. And how can this be possible, one may ask further? Well, we all know on our path we believe in reincarnation. And Yoganandaji once said that our outer garb, this body, changes. But there is one organ in the body which carries on just as it was left, you might say, in its state of evolution last time. And those are the eyes. He said, that's why Yogarandaji gave a very practical tool, actually. And let's see how we can help save a lot of trouble and time in our life by doing this. Let's say if you work in an office and you are running a company. Yogarandaji said, if you want to find soul friends or people who are in tune with your work, your mission, your ideals, you want to know who is really your family, he said, look into their eyes. Briefly. Let's say you're interviewing somebody. Of course, you want to know some questions here and there. But the gaze, Yogananda said, look for people who have intelligent eyes, bright, kind eyes, calm eyes. Not so much shifty, wondering what's in it for me, what can I get? You can make out those things from the eyes. So that was his counsel, that look at people who have those kind of eyes. Another thing Kriyanandaji said, that the position of our gaze is also very important. So now I'll actually touch on the theme also. There's so much to talk about eyes, but Kriyanandaji was chiefly saying that when we're having a communication, try to communicate with your eyes also. And actually, I have found as a teacher that this is something I have to again and again, you might say, remind myself or work upon. Because, we are often just trying to, first get the, you might say, basics together when we are doing a class or a communication. But you can see that Yogananda also said, when you're giving a talk, for example, to an audience for the first time, he said, very quickly, try to find those who are off our path or in tune, who need more energy. And then Kriyanandaji would say, just with a smile, and you can see in their eyes, some people are confused. Some people are sad. Some people are very eager. They are open. They are smiling. They are expressive. And we can gently have a great communication actually with our eyes. Kriyanandaji said that sometimes years after Master's passing, he said that he would just remember how in a particular moment, situation, Yoganandaji was looking at him or looking at somebody. I remember one time, we were having a meal with Swamiji. It was quite a big group. And somebody who was sitting very close to Swami, was slightly emotional. And they were asking a question in a slight exasperating way. And, I thought that, I was quite new on the path. That, that was a slightly, it was as if you had answered your trouble by saying that this is not right. And gently, many people were busy in food because this was a big group. He just looked at Swami and there was a gentle look of his eye that, and then he was very kind in replying back to the person. He didn't take it personally. So a glance, a small look here and there. Swami says those are ways of communication. I want to see one or two of the points I wrote down over here, which are also quite helpful. Yes. Now, eyes are, Master said, the windows to the soul, that is the organ we carry from one incarnation to the other. At the same time, in nature also, Paramahansa Yogarandaji suggested a few things where we can derive, like how I said, the photograph of a master can help us. He said that particularly looking at the rays of the setting sun are very beneficial. And I have found, see friends, sometimes we treat outer things, the sun, the moon, trees, and rocks and mountains, to be as if inert, literally. Oh, how, you know, what kind of communication can I have with them? Or again, we look at them as if they are dead. They are not. I remember one time somebody was telling me that, they couldn't sit in the sun. They had an allergy. And the person was a healer. I said, but the sun is having healing power. And, have you talked to the sun? I said, talking to the sun, what does that mean? I said, the sun gives energy, life to everybody, human beings, plants. I said, just talk to the sun that, hey, help me understand, help me overcome this obstacle. Please bless me. I want to benefit from your universal benevolence. And the person said, within next day, by the next day, that challenge was gone. And sometimes we create this barrier. And this is again, we are not talking about the sun over here. But the point I was making was, these things are alive. Yogananda Ji actually said, there are people living on the very physical sun of our solar system in energy or astral bodies. So looking at the sun which goes down, I was feeling as I was practicing, for this satsang, that also communicates, that also heals us. Likewise, the moon, Kriyananda Ji used to say, you can look at the moon, especially a full moon which is approaching. He said the full moon can bestow mental peace. It can fill your brain and mind with peace. If you look at the rays and invite that moonlight, he said you can feel immediately that coolness. And one time I remember Kriyananda Ji was feeling quite tired, and we met him and he said, I'm feeling so tired. And his body was not keeping well, especially in the last few years. And he said, must be the solar flares, I believe. And it was like how our body is connected to the electromagnetism, and on a deeper level, who knows. So that is another nice thing. When we are looking, we can communicate the same communication that we, Swami, suggesting we have with people. Now, of course, some of you who have pets, you will know this principle. The pets can not just sense your mood, but through your eyes. Through their eyes also, sometimes they weep if they are hurt or if you are hurt. So just the same way, include them in your communication. A moment here. Yes, these were the two stories I wanted to share. That Kriyananda Ji said, I heard these two stories actually. I didn't from him, not from him, but from other people. That when he had written the script for the Finding Happiness movie, and when it came time to choose the star, the actor, actress, and the director, they say that Swami met them very briefly, and they were carrying, as most of us would, all the profile of their past work. And it is said that the actress met him and Swami didn't even look at her file. He looked at her and he says, you have beautiful eyes. Will you act in this movie? And she said, yes. And later she said that she was just a week ago praying to God that give me a meaningful project. Her mother actually, this is an American actress, her mother had an Indian guru and had traveled to India decades ago. And this lady was saying that I was at that point in my life where I was seeking some direction, some meaning, and this thing came and Swami just cut across. Like I'm saying, if you're hiring somebody, look at their eyes. Kriyananda Ji would repeatedly give this example that men go more by logic. For hiring somebody, they would say, what is the qualification you have? How much experience do you have? How much money can you invest? And so on. But he says sometimes the wife comes in the picture and she'll say, I don't trust this person. Don't invest so much money. And the husband would say, what's wrong with you? Look at his credentials. We have an agreement over here. And Swami would say that, a few months down the line, the person would run away with the money. And you realize that how did the wife know? She could feel. They have intuition. And men also have it. It is a matter of developing feeling. And then that intuition can be very quickly, Master said, sense. Again, I'm not saying look into their eyes, just gently, feeling. It's not to judge again, but just to get to know. See, sometimes people are confused. You don't want to tell them, your eyes are confusing and I will not look at you. Swami said this is the safer ways to look at people's spiritual eye. But if you're trying to help, which he's suggesting over here, a gentle look, and then you can mold your counseling accordingly. There's another beautiful story in the same movie, actually. It is said that Swami picked up the director also in the same way. He said, "I like your eyes. Will you do this?" And in the 1960s, I think, or maybe 50s, Swami was once in Delhi. And he was in Connaught Place and he wanted to buy a gift for his friends back in the ashram. And he found a statue of, I think, the Madonna, and it was very beautiful. And he, sorry, maybe it was not the Madonna, it was another statue. And he, it was quite expensive though. So he asked the shopkeeper, "Can you give me a discount?" And the person said, "No, this is a government shop, sir. No discounts." And Swami said, "Well..." And then Swami said, I looked at him, I was like a friend, and I just gently requested. He said, "Come on, you can make it 10, make it 10%. And the person was slightly surprised. And he said, "Okay." And again, Swami said that I didn't hypnotize him or anything. But I just looked at him like a friend. "Come on, you can do this. I like this product of yours and I need to buy it. But give me something in exchange." So that kind of a thing. Make them understand what is your feeling, where are you coming from, that you want to befriend them. I've seen so many times, you know, people are not trusting. I just signed the lease for our, you know, how new center for Pune this afternoon with some friends, and we went through many, many people to reach the final agreement. And people would be like, you know, "Oh, you're an ashram, you have money, people always have money, and we won't give a discount," and so many things with all the different places I saw. But I saw that, you know, if you would gently, calmly, sincerely tell them, they understood those things. So friends, that is what I wanted to share. Of course, as I mentioned in the beginning, the position of the eyes also speaks quite a bit. When we are in meditation, the eyes go up. When we are looking down, we are in subconscious. And when we are conscious and aware, awake and ready, Kiranandaji said, when you want to do a simple, clear, sincere communication, he says, keep your eyes straight and relaxed. I hope these teachings were helpful. Let's see how we can practice them, and I look forward to more sessions on this evening platform. God bless you.